Ever guiding us into the higher things, the greater things, the more glorious things, calling us up, 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 causing us to mount up with wings as of eagles on the storms of life as we lay hold of your powerful, life-giving word. Wings of the Spirit, winds of the Spirit, on wings of faith. Thank you, Lord. Oh, we thank you. Thank you, Lord, for each one that's here. And thank you, Lord, for each one that's streaming live. Yes, we thank you for the family of God. We thank you. Yes, and by technology we can reach out, touch our friends, our partners all over the world. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. You're so good, so sweet, so wonderful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Lots of exciting things going on. Life is exciting. Getting up every morning is exciting.
It is.
It's exciting that you come into the house of God to worship God.
And when you're our age, no matter how young, you'll come to realize how exciting it is to get up in the morning. Just for you young people. Yes, on Periscope. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Well, this weekend, our Pastor Bill Sharp, is going to be here again. Now, we thought we'd never see him again. We were like, boo-hoo, when he left.
That's what he said.
Like when Paul left the Ephesians and they were crying on the shore because they thought they'd never see him again. Here he is again, coming back.
God has his way.
God has his way.
An old friend of his, Mel Larson, has passed away, and he's coming in to do the memorial on the 3rd, and so he's going to be with us on the 4th. Praise God for that.
Praise the Lord. I'm sure Nancy will sing for us, and so we will be very blessed that weekend.
Yes.
So glory to God. We can yield, can't we? We'll be flexible. Hallelujah. We're just so glad to see him again and his lovely wife. Praise the Lord. And so there we have it.
There we have it.
I think that's all I need to say.
All right.
So God bless you all. I'm glad that you're here. Pastor has a great word for us this morning.
Amen.
I know.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we pray, I pray, that these lips of clay will just be yielded to your Spirit in a way that will bring life to everyone here, and that you'll be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. I sure got a great wife. I tell you, I do. I think I'll keep her. If she'll keep me, I'll keep her. I guarantee you that. Oh, excuse me, my book is falling apart here. My goodness, how'd that happen? Oh, man. I did get a kick out of that Periscope adventure this morning. And it's interesting how so many people have the same questions, about do all ways lead to heaven? What about the Asians, that worship Buddha and this, that, and the other thing? The questions are always the same. After a while, you just kind of expect the same questions. People are searching for God. Young people are searching for God. I was at the Unity Prayer Saturday while the ladies were having their meeting here, and it was such a thrill. There was a young man there, first time I'd seen him, but I'll tell you, just on fire for Jesus, 14 years old. Yeah, I mean, on fire, just lit up. And he led prayer, and he preached first. I mean, he is excited about Jesus, and that's okay. Hallelujah. It's okay. Very exciting. But young people are looking for answers. They don't even know who they are. They don't even know what sex they are, a lot of them, unfortunately. I don't know why they're so worried about not knowing who they are. I just found out I'm not who I was. Took the DNA test, right? My mother had raised me, telling me that I was part Indian, 16th Cherokee to be exact, and that I was, German descent, all this kind of thing. And my DNA test came back, and I'm more British than the British are. I mean, serious, I'm more British percentage-wise than the British are, and I'm part Irish, of course, 16% I think it was, and a few other things. It don't amount to much, but so I didn't know who I was. One thing I was never confused about was, though, I was a boy. And you say, well, how can you be so sure? I said, it's easy. I just looked in my diapers and said, oh. Some of these things you can sort out pretty quick. You really can. Yeah. And the devil is having a field day, just kicking people around, young people especially. And the thing is that the truth, the absolute truth, the unchanging truth is in the Bible. I said it's in the Bible. It's the only place you can really find truth. You certainly can't find it with the politicians, can you? Or the media, right? I mean, it's everywhere. You're getting spins and lies and misconceptions, and anyway. You'll hear about that tonight. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Psalm 51. Let's go to Psalm 51. Glory to God. I'm just so excited. In case you've never noticed, I'm just really, really excited about the Holy Spirit. You say, well, what about Jesus? Well, my Bible says in Corinthians that the Lord is that Spirit. Jesus sent himself, if you will, or God himself, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, in the person of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. We believe in one God in three persons, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Nicene Creed, others. It's orthodox. It's the way God declared himself. In the beginning, he was both Eloah, which is singular, and Elohim, which is plural. And he began to reveal himself. Hallelujah. Awesome. Awesome. Do we understand it? No. No more than we do when Thessalonians tells us that we are a spirit that live, that have a soul, the seat of our will, our mind, our intellect, our emotions, and we live in a body. I mean, who can understand that? I haven't quite figured out an egg yet. With a yolk and white and a shell. There's a lot of things like that where God just kind of gives us pictures, says, you figure that out, kind of like what he told Job. Where were you when I did all this and said all this? Well, okay, we'll just yield to the Creator then. Amen? Amen. So anyway, the psalmist, I want to talk a little bit about the psalmist because the psalmist was seeking for things that you and I should be able to take for granted. And yet, for some reason, many resist There's only, God has not given us a spirit of fear. If you fear anything about God, there's something, a misconception. There's something wrong with the way you're thinking about God, because only every good and perfect gift comes down from Him. And so to not want or not like or not embrace any part of Him, you're robbing yourself. You've been deceived of the devil. You say, well, I can't be deceived of the devil. I'm a Christian. Well, good for you. But you're not infallible. Only Jesus was. And we're all, if you think you can't be deceived, you are. Amen. And we all have a lot of doctrinal differences, no doubt about that. That just seems to be the way people are. I'll get into that a little bit. Psalm 51, verse 10 and 11. Create in me a clean, morally, ethically pure and clean heart, O God, and repair or make new a right spirit, a firmly established, fixed, enduring spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh of God within me. And cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Right there, all the Calvinists go absolutely berserk. Say, well, what's a Calvinist? Well, the Protestant theological system of John Calvin and his successors, which developed Luther's doctrine of justification by faith alone, which, by the way, was what Halloween was all about. It's a Hallowed Eve. It's when it was Reformation Day. It was when Luther nailed his treatise on the door of the All Saints Catholic Church and started the Reformation, out of which Protestantism thrived and grew and so on. And so anyway, John Calvin, his successors, little doctrinal stuff here, which develops Lutheran's doctrine of justification by faith alone and emphasizes the grace of God, now listen to this, and the doctrine of predestination. So according to Calvinism, salvation is accomplished by the almighty power of the triune God. The Father chose a people, the Son died for them, the Holy Spirit makes Christ's death effective by bringing the elect to faith and repentance, thereby causing them to willingly obey the gospel. The entire process, election, redemption, regeneration, is the work of God and is by grace alone. Thus, God, not man, determines who will be the recipients of the gift of salvation. In other words, if He chooses to save you, you're saved, and if He doesn't, you're just plumb out of luck. You might as well not bother going to church, serving God, or doing anything else. Well, I have a problem with that, in case you can't tell. I'm a little biased on this. That's Calvinism. And there's hyper-Calvinism. And we see a lot of it. You may talk to people that say, well, I went to the altar. I'm saved. Once saved, always saved. Doesn't matter how I live, how I talk, what I'm doing. Well, I beg to differ. And that's okay. I mean, if you want to believe that, then when you stand before God Almighty, as we all will, you can explain to Him why it was that you didn't love Him enough to obey Him. At least that's my understanding. Now, according to Arminianism, the Dutch Arminianism was originally articulated by in the Remonstrance of 1610, a theological statement signed by 45 ministers submitted to the States General of the Netherlands. The Synod of Dort, 1618 and 19, was called by the States General to consider the five articles of Remonstrance, and these articles asserted that, number one, salvation and condemnation on the day of judgment was conditioned by the graciously enabled faith or unbelief of man. See, Calvin says it's totally up to God. Arminianism says you have a choice. God offers, but you can choose. That's what was just said here. The atonement, number two, the atonement, or being at one with God, is qualitatively adequate for all men. In other words, whosoever will. Doesn't your Bible say that? Whosoever will come to me, I will in no wise cast out. That's what he says. So the atonement is qualitatively adequate for all men, yet that, quote, yet that no one actually enjoys or experiences this forgiveness of sins except the believer, and thus is limited to only those who trust in Christ. So we have a choice, and the grace of God is to us who trust in Him, believe in Him. Number three, that man has not saving grace of himself, nor of the energy of his free will. And unaided by the Holy Spirit, no person is able to respond to God's will. Faith cometh by? Hearing by? Which is enlightened by the Holy Spirit. Amen. Number four, the Christian grace of God is the beginning, continuance, and accomplishment of any good. Yet man may resist the Holy Spirit. And number five, believers are able to resist sin through grace. Thank God for that. And Christ will keep them from falling. But whether they are beyond the possibility of ultimately forsaking God or becoming devoid of grace must be more particularly determined from the Scripture. So you see, there's quite a difference between Arminianism and Calvinism, where in the one case, all you have to do is just say, well, I hope I'm saved. I think I'm saved, but that's up to God. Kind of, that almost sounds like Allah. You don't really know where he stands at all. But the Arminian view is, of course, that we are saved. Yes, same basics of what Luther's treatise said. We're saved, Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. We're not saved by anything we do, but by grace through faith. And our faith is in that mix. And he beckons to all of us and says, if you'll just give your life to me, if you'll yield to me, then all the benefits are yours. But you do have a choice. You do have a choice. And that's basically where we pretty much settled in. I'm almost a little Calvinist, because I don't believe that we're just on a banana peel and you know, one little, you know, misstep and you're down and out. It's not that at all, because we are kept. If we're walking in faith, we believe God, we're doing the best we know how to do, then he leads us and he guides us and he keeps us. Amen. Hope you can agree with that. If you can't, you're probably in the wrong church. because there are those, that's what they believe. Pastor Luke talks to some of the young people all the time, and that's what they're into now, listening to the Pied Piper. Praise the Lord. But what a sobering thought. I mean, think about it. We should. We should have an awe, a fear of God, an awesome respect and fear of Almighty God, that God could actually remove his spirit from us. That's scary. Unless you're in love with Jesus, and then that doesn't even enter your thought. It shouldn't. I'm not going around worrying about whether Sharon is going to go cheat on me, whether she's going to be seeing somebody else, whether she's just going to one day say, that's enough of you, Bucky. I mean, she's had plenty of reason, but she just, that's not it. That's not what she's going to do. She'll kill me, maybe. You know, but never. See, that was our agreement even before we were saved. Murder, maybe. Divorce, never. It works. 55 years later, going on 56, we're doing pretty good. See, but I don't even consider that. That's not in my thinking. It's not in her thinking. Well, why should it be in a Christian's thinking? If we're in love with Jesus, we know he loves us. We got the deal sealed. So let's embrace his spirit and enjoy every moment. I love hugs. Don't you love hugs? I love hugs. I just love to snuggle and hug. A little kissing once in a while too, you know. I just love it, right? Why can't we be that toward God? See, it's not all I'm terrified of God, no, or I'm afraid of God, no, or I'm always walking in the fear of God, no, but nor am I always walking in, oh, I can do anything because he loves me so much. Well, real love doesn't allow a child to play on the street. It sets boundaries. God's love does too. Well, how can God remove his spirit from us? Well, how can that be? Let's look at this psalm in the context of one who's desperate to be right with God. That's me. And I believe that's you. You're just desperate to be right with God. You recognize your inadequacies, your frailties, your weaknesses, but you also recognize the tremendous, awesome power of God to keep you. He will keep that which is entrusted to him. That's Bible. That's truth. So, Psalm 51, 1 through 13. Have mercy on me, upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions, he's crying. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. I pray this prayer. The difference is that I thank him for doing it. He did it. The blood washes over me and cleanses me from all unrighteousness. When I sin, I said when, not if, when. I mean, there's a stumbling. Somebody ticks me off. I mean, anger worketh not the righteousness of God. I don't know what it is. I don't think major problems, but there are still those human issues that I'd love to see just stripped out of my life. Then I can come to him with 1 John 1:9 and ask for forgiveness. And he's faithful and just to forgive me my sin, cleanse me from all unrighteousness. So it's really not about perfection. You've got to be perfect. He knows you can't. That's why he sent Jesus. But that's not an excuse for you to be your own bad self. Just because you want to. It's this wonderful balance. This wonderful relationship. It's relationship. It's not, one of the kids said, you know, well, which religion is right? I said, none of them. I mean, really, religion, pooey religion, is God, is man trying to do something to please God and get to God? You can't. You've got to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And once you have that, everything else just kind of explains itself, takes care of itself. So you and I, as born-again believers in Christ, have had this prayer answered already. God has extended his mercy upon us because of his great love. He's chosen to remove every stain of our sin by means of the blood of his Son, who offered himself as a willing sacrifice on the cross of Calvary. Hallelujah. And he knew what he was getting. And yet he called us the prize. Called you and I the prize. Oh boy, you got a prize, all right. He said, that's all right. I knew what I was getting. I can handle you. Don't let your pride get in the way and think God can't handle you. God is the only one who can. When his love and his mercy are recognized, we admitted our sinful nature and our acts of sin. That's what's called repentance. It's what hyper-Calvinists don't even believe in. They don't think you have to repent for anything. But you do. You need to recognize good and evil, right and wrong, holy and pure versus the impure and the profane. And then be willing to just turn away from all of that that corrupts and putrefies and face God, his holiness, his purity, and determine to live a holy life. Knowing you can't do it without him, but he won't make you, so he won't do it without you. Repentance, for I acknowledge my transgression, my sin is ever before me. And like the prodigal son, we have to recognize that even when we're doing something or saying something that's against another human being, we're actually doing it and saying it against God. If it's wrong, it's wrong. If it's sin, it's sin. But we sin against him. Luke 15:21, the son said unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight, and therefore am no more worthy to be called your son. But what happened? The father killed the fatted calf, put the ring on him, put the robes on him. That's the way God is. Welcome home, son. Welcome home, daughter. If you'll come. Right? Standing on the road waiting. That's where the hug part comes in. It really does. Hallelujah. So against thee and thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest. So the psalmist recognized original sin. As we can see by verse 5, it says, Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. And some people say, wait a minute, my mom was really a good Christian. She was a wonderful person. What do you mean I was conceived in sin? I mean, she was married. What are you talking about? It's the doctrine of original sin. Adam and Eve fell, and we have carried that fall all throughout the DNA of humanity. That's why we need Jesus. Just that simple. That's why the Bible says in Romans, all, that includes all of us, have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So we do need a Savior. And we were shaped in iniquity, and in sin we were conceived because we were of the fallen nature of man. Until we were born again. There are a lot of people running around, well, I believe in God, I believe in Jesus, you know, but it ain't working for me. You know what? You need to get saved. I'm serious. Well, I went to the altar, but something did not happen. If you didn't make the connection, you need to go to the altar until you connect. I don't have a problem with people, you know, saying the sinner's prayer more than once. I just want it to work, because you and I both know that if you're really born again, something went off on the inside of you and you were not who you were before. Old things passed away. All things became new. Hallelujah. You were a new creature. And even when you wanted to go, you know, your brain, you wanted to go do what you did before, you just can't have any fun at it anymore. Can't even have fun sinning anymore. Thank God. So, it's no wonder then that he desires we be filled with truth. John 17:17, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. We put the word in and we're getting truth, and it's pushing out the error, the misconceptions and the lies. And wow. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts and in the hidden part. It says in verse 6, thou shalt make me know wisdom. And then in verse 7, it says, purge me with hyssop, I shall be clean. Wash me, I shall be whiter than snow. Hyssop was a type of the blood of Jesus, and the psalmist is crying out for what you and I already have available in Christ. The blood that speaks. Hallelujah. The blood of Jesus doesn't hide our sin, thank God for that, but totally obliterates it, removes it as far as the east is from the west. Verse 8, make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins, blot out all mine iniquities. And we say, yes, amen, we the redeemed, filled with the joy of having heard the good news of the gospel, and are, or at least should be, filled with gladness and rejoicing. Oh, what I've been saved from, I well know. our two initial verses, Psalm 51, 10 and 11. Create in me a clean, morally, ethically pure and clean heart, O Lord, our God, and renew or repair or make new a right spirit, a firmly established, fixed and enduring spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh within me. Cast me not away from my presence, excuse me, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. When we were born again, our spirit was made brand new. Brand new. I have some here. Thank you so much. Yeah, bless you. And God in Christ was giving us His Spirit to abide with us, firmly established, fixed, and enduring. I get those things from the original language. They're just, they're in there. The Greek language, the Hebrew language, all the languages of the Bible are just their pictures. They're beautiful. That make up a tapestry of the meaning doesn't change from what we may just read in English, but it just goes deeper. The words of the Lord are purified in the furnace of the earth seven times. I believe there's at least seven levels of revelation in every scripture, and it never contradicts just the plain, simple truth of what we read. But it takes us deeper so we can appreciate more fully what's being said. A right spirit, a firmly established, fixed, and enduring spirit that is commingled together with our spirit. And we're actually fulfilling Jesus' prayer that we be one with Him, even as He is with the Father. That's why He can say, the Bible can say, He's the head and we're the body. We're not separate. I said we're not separate. We're one with Him. That's powerful. That's a thing, that's a work of the Spirit. That's why it says if you're doing unclean things, you're actually causing the Lord to participate in them. If you're using unclean language, you're actually causing the Lord to participate against His will. We're not our own. We're bought with a price. We live, yet not we, but Christ. So what a powerful, awesome truth. And because of our personal individual frailties, weaknesses, the things that God is working on while we are being in the process of being sanctified, we can look and say, well, I'm not holy, I'm not pure, I don't think God can do it. Excuse me. He can do it if you just let Him. We're no longer hopeless. Now we're filled with hope, which should permeate our whole being with salvation's joy. What have I got to be concerned about, upset about, mad about, fretful about? Nothing. I'm saved, for crying out loud. My eternal destiny is already established. I've got a ticket. I'm not going to argue with you about whether you're pre-trib or mid-trib or post-trib or whatever. I don't care. I got a ticket. I'm going when the bus goes. That's all I care about. Huh? Yeah. We're talking about salvation. I die, I'm just stepping over into glory land. Hallelujah. I think my mama, I know she'll be there. Praise the Lord. I hope my daddy will be there. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Restore unto me, verse 12, the joy of my salvation. Uphold me with thy free, inclined, willing, noble, princely, generous spirit. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Filled with His Spirit, immersed in His Word. We're now equipped to be witnesses of His goodness and His glory. What's a witness? I've been there. I saw it. I tasted it. I touched it. Somehow, I was an actual witness. We went to Roy's Hawaiian restaurant, right, on Thanksgiving and had Thanksgiving dinner. And I touched it and I smelled it and I looked at it and I tasted it. And I can tell you everything that's good about it. I can tell you what I didn't like. I can tell you what I like. Why? Because I'm a witness. Huh? I'm a witness of what it's like to be a hopeless, helpless sinner with a foul mouth and a perverse mind. And I can also tell you what it's like, because I've experienced it, what happens when Jesus comes into your heart and your life and you're really born again, and all of a sudden the weight of the world lifts off and everything, all the colors look just awesome. The reds are more red, the yellow's more yellow, the blue's more blue. Everything is gorgeous. Even red hair. Really, it's gorgeous. I mean, think about it. You know, if you're colorblind, you wouldn't know. It's a good thing to be spiritually colorblind. Thank you for your amen. The problem is there's way too many Christians, so-called, Isaiah 63:10, but they rebelled and vexed his Holy Spirit. Therefore, he was turned to be their enemy. And he fought against them. I don't want God fighting against me. I don't want him fighting against you. Gosh, what's it take? Just stay in love with him. Stay in relationship with him. Let him have your life. How can we reject the gift of God, our Father, and say we consider him good? I wonder that. I ponder that. I don't understand that. Luke 11:13, if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask? Why wouldn't we ask? Why wouldn't we receive? Why wouldn't we chase after him like a deer chases after the water brooks, panting after him? If there's more, I want more. If there's whatever, whoever you are, I want to know you. I want to know all about you. I want to know what you smell like. I want to know the sound of your footsteps. You know, I can tell when Sharon's, if it's Sharon or not walking, I can even tell if it's my puppies or not walking in the house when it's totally pitch black and dark, because I know the sound, the pace, the rhythm. I want to know God like that. And we can only do that through his Spirit. If we have the same passion as the psalmist, we should be earnestly seeking the fullness of all that Jesus died to provide. All. All. Having been sealed with the Holy Spirit, we shouldn't desire to know him. I mean, we should desire to know him more and more and more and more every passing day. Ephesians 1:13, in whom you also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, which would have been enough, by the way. Dianu, would have been enough if all he did was save us. I mean, that's more than we deserve, for sure. But he gave us everything necessary for life and godliness, and in whom after that you have believed, you were sealed with who? The Holy Spirit of promise, of promise, of promise, of promise. Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. Ephesians 4:30 says, whereby you're sealed unto the day of redemption. Hallelujah. I'm being held in the everlasting arms. He has me in his hand, and he has me in the Father's hand. I'm doubly held. As long as I want to be, I'm in. Should we dare grieve the Holy Spirit of God by not giving him his rightful place in our lives? You say, well, what is that? That's total, absolute control. If a man controls his tongue, he's perfect. Who is controlling now? Oh, but I don't understand it. Yeah, but who's... You don't have to know how to drive to have a driver drive you around, a chauffeur take you where you want to go. That's the problem. We think we know where we want to go. We don't know where we want to go. We don't know what we're capable of. We don't know where we're headed for. We don't know what the divine plan is. I mean, there's a certain amount in the Bible and the Spirit and the Word agree, so there's nothing contrary to the book, but there's an individual revelation, calling, mandate for each of us that we will only know by the Spirit of God. Our cry should be, come, Holy Spirit, you're welcome here. You're welcome here. I don't care what happens in church, especially. I do, but I just want you here. You said, right here, I'm the temple, the naos, the holiest of all places of the Holy Spirit. Come, you're welcome here. Enomo sekelebo shalabasa mumbreste boko shoko malo boko hora. I'm going to pour out of my Spirit on all flesh, and this is the hour when sons and daughters will prophesy, hallelujah, and decree a thing, and it shall be. Oh, hallelujah. Jesus commanded us to receive His Spirit so that we could function in the fullness and walk in realms of glory that the man bound by his flesh can never attain to. Prayer life is everything, but if all it is us recounting our requests and our feeble understanding of the world. I mean, look at how many Christians, quote unquote Christians, were praying for someone to win the election other than who won. Well, either God is really confused or somebody missed something. You understand what I'm saying? I'm not saying one's right or one's wrong. It's just we are schizophrenic or confused or something. We're not spending enough time, which is pretty obvious because somebody in 2010, 2011 said who was going to win, and he won. Several other prophets. And what did God say? I won't do anything without first telling my prophets. And what did the Bible say? You and I are greater than John the Baptist, who was counted as a prophet. We're all supposed to be prophets, which means we're not spending enough time to really hear what the Spirit is saying so that we can actually begin to guide a people and guide a nation and guide a world into the glorious presence of Almighty God who created everything. Whoo! You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you'll be, there it is, witnesses. You'll experience some things that most people have not seen, not tasted, not heard, not felt. But you'll be able to bring it to the table of the Lord and to share it. Kelebose, brestosta. If I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prays, my mind is unfruitful. I don't understand it. Maybe that's why in 1 Corinthians 14:13 he said, pray that you may interpret. Hmm. man can't baptize you. Religion can't baptize you. Your denomination can't baptize you in the Holy Spirit. John 7:38 says, "He that believeth on me, as the scriptures have said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water." And I do understand that the river, the water of God, is the Word of God, but it's only living water when it's quickened by the Spirit of Almighty God. Or we wouldn't have Arminians and Calvinists. We wouldn't have, all the rest of these isms and schisms. And if we could really plug into the Holy Spirit and say, "You wrote the book, now teach me. Show me. Reveal Jesus to me. You said you'd reveal Jesus. I want to see Jesus. And only you can show me Jesus because you're the Spirit of the Lord." Kilabo seke, mambo rete, come, Holy Spirit. You are welcome here. Oh, my. See, your prayer language, tongues, is given to you personally so you might speak privately to your Creator and share, the word is mysteries, secrets, hidden things with Him that nobody and nothing, no demon, no devil, no human being, not even you, can understand until He brings it up into your consciousness and interprets. And most all of the time, it'll take your breath away and you go, "I never saw that. I didn't know. Forgive me, I didn't know." "Well, then build me up." He said, "No, you build yourself up." "Why?" "Yeah. He that speaks in an unknown tongue edifieth continually, continually edifieth, builds himself up, builds himself up." Shanamoseke leboko ho rashataka. I wonder how many of our little sinful acts would vanish and vaporize if we spent a little more time. Because, beloved, I know people that memorize the Bible, that know it word for word. They can finish. I mean, you start a chapter, they'll finish the whole chapter, and yet they'll go home and they'll chase their live-in, around with a knife or a hatchet. I actually knew a couple that was just like that. They walking Bible, had it all in his head, but there was no quickening of the Spirit of God. I look at people walking in legalism and bondage, and they're word spouters, but the letter kills. When the Spirit wants to take it and make it life. Jesus came, we had life and have it more abundantly. Yeah. Hallelujah. I've already gone too long, I can tell. Jude 1:20 says, "Build yourself up in your most holy faith, praying" what? "In the Holy Spirit." Oh, well, I'm led by the Holy Spirit when I pray in English. Yeah, you may be, but you're still only got one oar in the water. And your boat is circling. Well, I know I'm preaching to the choir, but number one, you're here. You've done the whole salvation thing, but you know you're not saved. I mean, you don't have a relationship. Every little thing goes a little haywire in your life, and you're cussing and fussing and just all upset. And, you don't have hope. Faith, righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Ghost. I don't want you to come up here and just say a prayer, but if you're ready to really make Jesus both Lord and Savior, I want you to come to the altar right now. For those of you that are watching on the internet, if you've never accepted Jesus Christ, do it. But don't think that just the mechanics are going to do it. Bring your heart, repent before God, and let His Spirit give you life. Shadamasika. Anybody, don't. If you don't confess Him, actually confess Him as Lord and Savior before men, He says, I won't confess you before my Father. Public profession just says, yeah, I'm declaring to the world, Jesus Christ is my all in all. I am His now and He's mine. If that's you, come before we have communion. Get right with God. You tasted the heavenly gift and you turned and just wallowed around in the pigsty like the prodigal son. Come home. You can come back. You can come home. You can enter into the fullness. Don't let another day go by trying to do it on your own. Omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, Thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome. You're welcome here. For a visiting evangelist to have our lives change. We just need to make a decision. God, do it. Oh, I thank God for the traveling ministers, the real evangelists, the anointed men and women of God. This is the day. Salvation. Choose you this day who you'll serve. God's not an add-on. Jesus isn't an extra in the play of life. Keep the main thing the main thing. So if you're settled with Him, comfortable with Him, comfortable in your own skin, you've let your baptism with the Holy Spirit just slip off into another extra. I just want you to stand right where you are and begin to praise Him in your prayer language. To just release the Spirit within you and let Him bring you fresh life. Oh, your mind will roll the word like waves while you're praying in tongues. That's not what you're praying in tongues. That's just simply keeping your mind set on Him. But there will be some where He'll just bring to your remembrance. It's one of the promises the Holy Spirit will bring to your remembrance whatsoever Jesus has said to you, and it'll just fill your being, and And then on even an intellectual level as well as a spiritual level, you're just going to be built up and encouraged and strengthened. Right where you are, just stand and worship Him. If you've never been baptized with the Holy Spirit, it's not a man that will do it. All you need to do is say, Jesus, I know you're the baptizer. John the Baptist said he baptized with water, but you were coming to baptize with the Holy Spirit. Right now, I receive. I believe I receive. And then just begin to give it voice. So all he needs is the sound. Haramonana ko rebashaka. Boredo de levo katabalamasha. Shomomo. 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 Breaking, breaking, breaking. Shomomo. Broken, broken, shomomo, broken, breaking. Aramomomo, shomomo, kolomoko, sekele bakata. A breakthrough, a release. The fountain, the deep, calling to deep at the noising of her water spouts, breaking forth to flood your world, your earth, your life. Elebobabalakata with living water. Bringing the Word of God alive, bringing life alive, quickening you. Seboroboko shakata. Boreste kelamosta lamaka. Shalomoko, shalomoko. Jesus' name. Stand and praise Him. He is worthy. Yeah. In spirit. Holy God. We have communion. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hi, I'm Pastor George Stover, and I want to invite you to come and join with us as we build the kingdom of God at Wellspring Church of All Nations. We're located at 8140 West Lone Mountain Road. There's also an entrance off of 4870 Janelle Drive. There is nothing more important to you and I today than the Word of God. If we don't learn as a people, as a nation, to return to the Bible, to return to faith in Jesus Christ and Him alone, we're not going to have the country that we've had, the one that I grew up in. I want my grandchildren and my children, your children and your grandchildren to live in the America I grew up in. But you know, it's going to depend on us, the people of faith. We have to get into the Word and just stick with it. And having done all, stand. And so we're really, really wanting you to come and just be a part of who we are, what we're doing here, because it's really all about you.